get started. Okay. All right, everybody. I think you might be under the misapprehension that this is some sort of poetry slam where you're going to be physically harmed in any way, but there's plenty of room up front. These are the more, usually the more expensive seats, but if you guys like to sit back there, it's fine. So I am Professor Brian Keating. I'm an astrophysicist in the Center for Astrophysics and Space Sciences within the Department of Physics at UCSD. I guess I'm also technically the associate director of the Arthur C. Clarke Center for Human Imagination, which is just one of the biggest treats that I have, which is to work with this incredibly eponymously intellectual gathering of scholars and scientists and artists, which is really kind of my ideal ever since I was a kid, would be around people that would raise my IQ level significantly. And one of those people is a mentor and friend of mine, Rae Armantrout. So it's really nice to be here tonight with her to celebrate a new birth of hers, a recent birth, which is a new book, which is on sale, and you should buy multiple copies. And Rae tells me it's more important that you buy it than you read it. But you should do both, because it's full of wisdom and insight. So first, I'd like to begin by thanking everybody, especially Rae, Amelia, and Brandon, who are going to be in conversation tonight. I'm the token scientist tonight, although Rae does a pretty good job as an so-called amateur scientist. I consider her a polymath, but maybe she should be really a poly-poet because she does so many interesting things. We'll hear a lot more from her and about her later on tonight. I'd also like to thank our founding sponsor at the Clarke Center, which is Viasat, and what we call the Founder's Orbit. You may know that Arthur C. Clarke pioneered this notion of geosynchronous satellite orbit as a methodology for telecommunications, which we do employ for the last 50 or so years. It's actually his 100th anniversary of his birthday, I guess you'd say. Reminds me of what Woody Allen was asked, what do you want people to say about you in 100 years? And he said, I want them to say I look pretty good for a 157-year-old. So he's looking better than ever, leering down upon Rae. And I want to thank you all for coming, because it's going to be a special evening. So what are we at the Arthur C. Clarke Center for Human Imagination? I think it's a unique center. It's something that's doing something to try to understand perception, the mind, consciousness, creativity, by bridging gaps between science and the arts, humanities, and technology and engineering. And we have all sorts of scholars that make up this center, young and old, faculty, grad students, et cetera. And we do a variety of events that I encourage everyone to be involved with. I'll talk very briefly about some of them. But the thing that most comes to mind is this buzzword, interdisciplinarity. Everybody's talking about that. My kids are talking about that. No. But it seems to be a big thing, and it is important. I think it does really relate to the notion of what a university is for, which is to really blend together these so-called two cultures, C.P. Snow called them, arts and sciences, really make a third one, which is some kind of melange of both put together. So it's really great fun to be a part of it. We do all sorts of things, from perception, human emotions, to creativity and studying questions that are of great interest to me. How do you teach someone to be creative? That's a wonderful question, something that we embark on. We teach classes together, scientists and artists, poets and physicists. We've co-taught a class, Rae and I, dancers and astrophysicists, and many other cognitive scientists working together with physicians. It's really a unique experience that we have on this campus, and really nowhere else that I'm aware of, relatively in the local part of the world. So we've had a lot of different recent events, and we continue to do things every year. We have a Clarion Science Fiction Workshop every summer. That will be held again on campus, as it often is. We also have an event coming up in just about 2 weeks here at the Price Center. This is sponsored by the Clarke Center, and it's an event with George R.R. Martin, who is responsible for Game of Thrones, I'm told. I'm actually not an avid viewer of that particular program, but I'm told it's quite spectacular, and I'm sure you guys know way more about it than I do. Kim Stanley Robinson, who's an alumni of UCSD, I am very familiar with, and he's a great intellect, and he will be in conversation with George, and that will be taking place, as I said, just about 2 weeks from now at the Price Center West Ballroom. So it's another unique experience. We have scientists, artists together working, and we also encourage, as we will tonight, interaction between the public. I mean, after all, you pay our salaries here, and we encourage that, and we invite you to take part in all these things, which are uniquely free and hopefully very stimulating artistically, intellectually, in other words. Sheldon Brown has done events, and he's our executive director. He's not here tonight, but he's responsible for organizing many of these events. And you should take note that we do a lot of events that we're taking part in. Oh, this is where I should have shown this before. Here's just some information. The Clarion workshop will be this summer. And it is remarkable that UCSD has produced so many outstanding science fiction writers, in addition to all the other forms of literature that we are expert in and world-renowned for. That will be held over the summer on campus, and there'll be events associated with that as well, bringing these great scholars to campus. And here's the logo that I should have shown that you guys probably instantly recognize and have tattoos of on your bodies, I'm sure. We've also had a couple of interesting events just in the past couple of months that we've archived and tied into a new endeavor that we've launched that I'll talk about in just a bit. But these are the most recent, very noteworthy events that attracted huge crowds, not unlike tonight, but there's been great excitement. And the events that we've sponsored, one was called How to Make a Spaceship, and that was with author Julian Guthrie and her collaborator Peter Diamandis, who's notable for founding the X Prize Foundation that got the first human commercial endeavor into space in the, about 10, 12 years ago. And Brian Binney, who is the pilot of that spacecraft as well. We had an event in November with the two of them, sorry, the three of them. We also had, right before the Arrival movie was launched, we had an event here on campus featuring featuring Ted Chiang, and it was the San Diego premiere, and that was quite remarkable to have that, and then it received so much attention and Oscar buzz, etc. Also, notwithstanding the Oscar buzz that was both received and the attention given to it, just last month we had Dr. Jedediah Eisler and Dr. Yvonne Cagle speak at UCSD, again in the Price Center, about this magnificent movie called Hidden Figures, which again, these are all combinations to take a scientific story. You know, scientists are humans, and they have souls not unlike artists, but to actually bring that to a compelling fruition as an artistic work is a tremendous achievement. And so these fantastic scientists were here speaking in conversation about what this movie was about, its importance, and the women behind it. And I thought that was quite exciting. And you might recognize Dr. Yvonne Cagle wheeled Dr. Kathleen Johnson out onto stage to present the Oscars this past February, I guess it was, right before there was a huge meltdown. It wasn't her fault. The wrong movie got the Oscar at the end. Even I saw that. Even I heard about that. But the last thing I want to talk about is our newest endeavor, which is called Into the Impossible, which is a phrase that Arthur C. Clarke himself uttered. He said the only way to determine what's possible is to venture a little bit going into the impossible. And I like to point out that the word impossible actually means I'm possible. If you break it up, put a little apostrophe there. Okay, Ray will correct my grammar, but that's actually correct, I'm told. So this is a podcast that we do about once a month, and it's put together with help by Patrick, who's around here somewhere. There he is. He deserves a huge round of applause for putting everything together tonight. And this is, we call it a meditation, if you will, a speculative ideas. How do we bridge these two cultures to make this unique third new culture? We put out one, as I said, about once a month. We had one just last month, or actually two last month, and we'll be releasing the newest one, I believe, in the next week or so, featuring interviews with Yvonne Cagle and Professor Adam Burgasser, who's a member of the Center for Human Imagination as well. There's also a book, again, another alumni of UCSD, science fiction author, famed science fiction author, David Brin. And this is a compilation. This is a work that really spans multiple different perspectives on what the future may be like, ranging from artificial intelligence to encryption to information theory and all the perils and pitfalls therein. So the last thing I want to do is encourage you guys to subscribe to things like the podcast, to get involved with the Arthur C. Clarke Center for Human Imagination. Visit our website, imagination.ucsd.edu. You can subscribe to our podcast on iTunes or any other podcatcher that you use. And tonight I'd like to introduce our introducer, which will be Professor Amelia Glaser, who's going to describe the following events for the evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. It's really an honor to have been invited to be part of this evening. I've long been an admirer of Rae Armantrout's work, who I have the privilege of calling my colleague, although she's now retired, but she remains our colleague forever. I'm really excited to be celebrating the work of Rae and also to get to think about the intersection between poetry and science. I have a confession to make, which probably won't surprise many of you. With the exception of one course I took in college on musical acoustics, I have never studied physics, and I feel like that's a huge gap in my education. Miraculously, this gap did not completely deter my partner, Iran, who's here tonight, and who was a graduate student in physics when we met. Instead, he gave me a book of Feynman diagrams as a gift and walked me through many of these elegant figures. I was at the time doing my own graduate degree in comparative literature and especially was focusing on Russian literature. And the poets that I continue to be the most closely engaged with are writers that came of age with the Russian Revolution. That's kind of the obvious historical event that happened in their young lives. But they also came of age when Einstein became an international celebrity in 1919. And even before that, Einstein had captured the imagination of modernists across languages who had become convinced that reality was more than we could see. The Soviet avant-garde filmmaker Zygovyertov, I'm going to give a lecture on Zygovyertov tomorrow, it so happens, to my undergraduates, sketches his plans for an anti-narrative cinema in his 1922 manifesto. He writes, "Drawings in motion, blueprints in motion, plans for the future, the theory of relativity on the screen." The Russian literary theorist Roman Jakobson, who happened to be best friends with Vladimir Mayakovsky, remembers that Mayakovsky was certain that science was on the brink of conquering mortality, and that he only had to get his mind around the physics of relativity to understand how. He said to Jakobson, "I've got to find some scientist who will give me a precise account of what's in Einstein's books." And of course, the Italian futurists who were obsessed with speed were also interested in this idea of time being relative to space. The Yiddish poet Peretz Markish, who I'm continuing to work on right now, compared himself in 1917 to an immaterial present. He wrote, "I'm yours, non-existent now, blindly and blind I am rich. We both die in an instant and will be instantly reborn." So Rae Armantrout's poetry is of a very different generation, but she betrays a similar excitement about being present and being part of her present, as well as about the evolving scientific discoveries of our present today. I see in the poems in this chapbook a continuation of an exploration that we've seen in Rae's past poems, especially in her 2009 Versed. This is the book, of course, that won her the 2010 Pulitzer Prize, as well as the National Book Critics Circle Award. Being awarded both of these prizes has been achieved by a very, very small number of people, two or three, I think. There, physics and biology merge to form an exploration of the fragile body. And since then, Rae has continued to push further in merging science and poetry, not only in her writing, but also in her teaching. She and Brian have co-taught this course on poetry for physicists, which is, of course, a really wonderful play on the cliche of physics for poets, which I think was the course I took in college, the musical acoustics course. They didn't call it that, but I think that's what it was. Rae Armantrout has authored 13 books of poetry, most recently Wobble, which will be coming out next year. And tonight is dedicated to, in many ways, this book especially is dedicated to the science in Rae Armantrout's poems. The poems in this little chapbook, which is made up of poems from all of these other volumes, they're perfectly complete as poems in and of themselves, but they're also all punctuated with questions that refer to the incomplete scientific and creative process and that make us think about the points at which those two processes merge. And so before Rae comes up, I just wanted to read some of the lines from these poems that are formed as questions, that interrupt the poems, So for example, interrupted by what? How could speed take shape? Hush, do you want me to start over? Ask what it means to pass through the void. Ask how it differs from not passing. With that, it's really a pleasure to cede the stage to Rae Armantrout.
Thank you, Amelia. That was really nice. Well, I really feel like I've gotten myself in over my head, finally, being here at the Clarke Center, because unlike Amelia, I never took a course in physics in college. It's true that I went to college in the Jurassic period, when that wasn't as necessary as it is now. But I didn't ever think I was interested in physics until the late 90s, I guess. And I'm still, as Brian says, very much interested as a layperson. I mean, you know, I can barely balance my checkbook. But I discovered that I liked reading the mini books, because now there are mini books explaining the latest theories in physics. And I liked them, I think, partly because I like to be puzzled. I mean, being puzzled, running up against some kind of conundrum, is often what gets me writing, what starts me on something. And it's, you know, it could be reading about chirality, or it could be something as simple as, why is this movie popular, or why do I find that tree beautiful, or in one recent case, why is the brand name of my new underwear Metaphor? But I got a poem out of that too. But none of those poems are in this book. These poems all bounce off of issues in physics that I came across in my readings. My hope is that the poems will be somehow apt in depicting the current aspects of current scientific knowledge, while also exploring human psychological and social conditions, and that they can find ways of bringing those two realms up against each other. Okay, what I'm going to do is read a few poems from this little booklet. Some of them I will introduce or make remarks about, either before or afterwards, and others I'll just read without comment. Okay, I will say something about this first poem, Accounts, which is dedicated to Brian Keating, and it involves our first meeting. It was summer. I think it was maybe, what year do you think it was, 2012? Yeah. And I had watched a nature program, I think, about the beginning of the universe. Narrated by Morgan Freeman, as so many of them are. And he was talking about basically how energy is converted into matter, into particles. And that left me with a lot of questions. I mean, I'm familiar with the concept, but even when you know the concept, you still sort of, don't you, even you scientists out there, don't you still kind of go, what? So I thought, well, maybe I could get a hold of a real physicist or astrophysicist, cosmologist, and ask him to explain some of the seemingly inexplicable things that I had heard. And Brian, so I wrote to, or actually, I believe first I had my one of the administrative assistants in our office contact the administrative assistant in physics, and somehow then Brian and I got in touch, and Brian was kind enough to actually meet with me, although I know that he gets a lot of mail from people who think they have questions or have something to tell him, like the world's going to end tomorrow or something. But he was kind enough to meet with me. And I asked him my questions. I can't remember specifically what my questions were. And I can't remember what he answered. nor did I understand his answers very well. So this poem is clearly not a transcription of our conversation, but it's a sort of absurdist version of it that maybe instead of solving the problems, instead of getting answers to the questions, it just puts the questions in the maybe simplest and most naive form. That's one thing it does. Okay, so now I'll read it. Account for Brian Keating. Light was on its way from nothing to nowhere. Light was all business. Light was full speed. When it got interrupted. Interrupted by what? When it got tangled up and broke into opposite. Broke into brand new things. What kinds of things? Drinking cup, thinking of you, convenience valet. How could speed take shape? Hush, do you want me to start over? The fading laser pulse, information describing the fading laser pulse, is stored, is encoded in the spin states of atoms. God is balancing his checkbook. God is encrypting his account. This is taking forever. This one I'll read and then I'll say a little bit about it afterwards. Dress up. To be dressed is to emit virtual particles. The spirit of renormalization is that an electron all by itself can have infinite mass and charge, but when it's dressed, a toddler stares at us till we look up. Flirtatious, we call it. She waits until we get the joke about being here, being there. Well, all right, I don't remember exactly what started me down the track of writing this poem, but I was reading something about renormalization, which is, you know, so freaky. I mean, you know, I'm going to say something wrong now, but forgive me. So particles, I guess, can have infinite, with measurements of them can come up with results of infinity, which, you know, no one expects or wants. So the process of crossing out infinity is called renormalization. And this thing that I was reading not only had that very interesting word, I mean, obviously a poet, a literary person, can't pass the word renormalization without making note. And then it was also very notable that the way that the particle gets renormalized is that it's surrounded by virtual particles, like a sort of a group of doppelgangers, and it becomes somehow real, i.e. finite, once it's surrounded by its doppelgangers, which is just such a weird idea, that I couldn't let it go. I had to pick, and that's called, when it has these virtual particles around it, that's called it being dressed. It gets dressed. So the language kind of grabbed me, the strangeness of the language as well as the concepts. And then in the second part of it, where the toddler is called flirtatious, well, that is a word that's sometimes applied to, you know, children playing peekaboo, especially if they're girls, probably unfortunately applied. But, you know, so that word is in quotes, too, as is dressed and renormalization. But I guess there is something, I saw a kind of potential connection between what the little girl was doing playing peekaboo and what the particles that scientists try to measure are doing, where they, you know, can be apparently in two places and at once unless you, you know, look at them just so. Okay, what should I read now? Spin. I'll just read this one and not comment on it, I think. it has, well, I'll say this, it has, along with the physics, it has some kind of obvious political content. Spin. That we are composed of dimensionless points, which nonetheless spin, which nonetheless exist in space, which is a mapping of dimensions. The pundit says the candidate's speech hit all the right points. Whoops. The page didn't turn right. Hit all the right points. Hit fed up, but not bitter. Hit not hearkening back. Light strikes our eyes, and we say, look there. Chirality. If I didn't need to do anything, would I? Would I oscillate in two or three dimensions? Would I summon a beholder and change chirality for him? A massless particle passes through the void with no resistance. Ask what it means to pass through the void. Ask how it differs from not passing. Those are just some of the questions I wanted to ask the author of a certain book, but of course he wasn't around. Outburst. What do you like best about the present? Reflection. Its spangle and its non-locality. Those eucalyptus leaves as points of light splashed over this windshield. What if every moment is a best guess on a pop quiz? As if waking up, I stop explaining Tony Soprano's outburst to his aggravated henchman. And then this next one, all I'll say about it is it kind of pokes at questions of necessity and law, as in the laws of nature. Making. What made this happen, you ask every time, as if compulsion itself were mandatory. The way light travels at the speed of light, because it must. It is in no sense essential that this crown of leaves sifted by wind, as if turning over some problem, is a gray-green brightening into rust-red at the tips, or that its equivocations fill this instant to the brim, while light has caught up to itself again and only seems to be making time. So just two more, in case you thought this was going to go on forever. This one is a little different because it came out of reading a book about biology, really, by a guy named Nick Lane. I think it's called Life Ascending. But when he writes about photosynthesis, he talks about the way that plants actually use the properties of quantum mechanics in order to photosynthesize. And that has been proven now. The emotional life of plants. An exciton consists of the escaped negative electron and the positive hole it left behind. This binary system is unstable and must be transported quickly to the processing center, which in practice means the exciton must be left strictly alone so that it travels all ways at once, going nowhere, but also going directly to the factory floor. Leaving aside the question of what it means for a positive hole to be left behind and also to travel as half of a system, this happens because nothing can be still, and because for the lonely, direction is meaningless. And then this will be the last one. Hence, sculpted minarets of clouds gone hence or thence. No dreams are that well formed. No one can depict the absolute bracelets of the orbits touched upon by electrons as feeling dithers between words.
Okay, so now I think we're going to have some discussion on the panel here. And then after that, we'll open it up to audience Q&A, or discussion, or alternate poems, if you'd like to respond with. And then we'll do a communal group poem at the end, which will be a surprise to everyone but Rae.
So yeah, I guess I'll start it out. I'm Brandon Som. I'm a professor here in the literature department, and I teach writing and poetry. And I have some of my students in the audience, so shout out to them. Excited to see you here. Thank you for that amazing reading, and I'm so excited to be here tonight. My first question, I kind of wanted to think more a little bit and celebrate this amazing union of poetics and physics, and kind of think about how it might not seem that poetry and physics are in conversation. But really, if we look at the tradition of poetry, we can go back to the Roman poet Lucretius and his book On the Nature of Things, a long poem which explores the theories of the atom. And then we could fast forward to American modernism and William Carlos Williams, a poet that your work, Rae, is often compared to, and a specific lecture that he gave in 1948 that I was looking at with my students this week in class, and in which he thinks about his conception of the variable foot and the line's new measure in relationship to Einstein's, to go back to Amelia's introduction, Einstein's theory of relativity. So this conversation has been going on for a long time, and so I'm really excited to see it in these poems as well, and to participate in the conversation tonight. But I was wondering if you could talk more about this amazing course that you guys taught together and how that conversation blossomed. And if you came away with some new discoveries yourselves as a result of teaching the course.
Well, I think it was Brian's idea. And we hoped to have a class full of physicists. We got a few, and also some biologists, some cog sci students, and some literature students. And it was a lot of fun. I mean, we talked about, you know, from our different perspectives, some of the things that the sciences and math have in common with poetry. That is, a drive towards compression, concision, and also the tendency to want to make equations. What is an analogy or a simile but a kind of an equation? Mm. I mean, it may not be as precise as a mathematical equation, but it's the same impulse to hold two things equal. So we talked about that, and I guess about the psychology of art and the psychology, if you can say such a thing, of science. What would you say about it, Brian?
Yeah, I'm looking up for my for my original notes on the class. Well, first of all, I should say it was so popular that the Regents decided to not renew it. So thank you, Regents. or at least UCSD's version of the Regents. so I was always inspired by... by Dirac, who, as I've said many times, complains so much about poetry that there's no way that he wasn't a deeply closeted poet. So one of his famous things that was, I would always say to make, you know, to be provocative, as is my wont, he said, in science, one tries to tell people, and he won the Nobel Prize for discovering antimatter or predicting antimatter, the positron and many other things, quantum mechanics. He said, in science, one tries to tell people in such a way as to be understood by everyone, something that no one ever knew before. But in the case of poetry, it's the exact opposite. This is one of his poems, and he would actually write poetry and then decry, you know, the lameness of poets. But I actually think, you know, actually the original Poetics, you know, as Brandon and Amelia can probably correct me if I'm wrong, but Aristotle, who was, you know, the first physicist, happened to be wrong about basically everything he ever said about physics, but he would talk about poetics and these notions of parsimony, as Rae mentioned, and symmetry, these things that are common between physics and maybe mathematics. Dirac also said famously, it's more important that my equations be beautiful than they be correct. And I think there is an artistic side of physics. There's something where there's no room for something to be extraneous, either in an experiment or in a theory. And I think, you know, Rae, you've described your work in poetry as the same. You'll go back and say, I don't really need this. And I think what we tried to explore the commonalities between the two and really attempting to answer the question of whether or not you can teach someone to be a poet. Can you teach someone to be a physicist? And I don't think I was wholly satisfied by the answer, but maybe if we get a chance to teach it again, that would be a fun thing to continue
exploring.
You know,
I've never heard you, can I ask Kim questions? I've never heard you answer that question. Can you teach someone to be a physicist?
I think
you're paid to do it. Can you do it?
That's right. So luckily none of my students are here. I think you can. I think you can lead them to a thought process which is scientific. Mm-hmm. In terms of, you know, creativity, I think there's just as much creativity in science as there is in the arts. And I think there's a trope that, you know, scientists are hyper-rational and you artists and literary folk are the passionate ones. But they're both crafts. I think that they're both crafts. And we both apprentice at the foot of, you know, masters in some sense. And that in a way, I think, you know, I once heard a painter describe how one should learn painting, and it was by copying the masters. And I think we do that in physics. It gives the wrong impression that, you know, history is written by the victor. You know, you kind of only learn the answer without learning. And there's a famous essay from the 70s called Should the History of Science Be Rated X? Because you only learn the answers, you know, after you never learn the puzzlement, the questions, the wrong turns, the missed opportunities. You just see the neat wrapped up in a bow final result. So I think you must include, you know, some sense of the greatness of who's gone before you. And I think you have to apprentice. Mm-hmm. I think, and those are the ways they'll give you the most likelihood of of being a creative scientist.
Well, and I think that you can't directly teach someone to be an artist or a poet, but you can get them to read. You can point them in the direction of, you know, the greats who have gone before. And also maybe notice what they like, what their predilections are, and then point them in that direction and get them to read things they didn't know about. And then either they take it from there or they don't.
I wanted to ask you, Rae, about the first poem that you read, which is also the first poem in the book and is dedicated to Brian, and accounts.
I get 10 cents every time it's read. Little known fact.
The poem is about the transfer of photons into matter. And it starts, you know, light was all business, and then later, when it got tangled up and broke into opposites. And the poem distills this transformation of photons into matter. It's a process that Feynman illustrates through his diagrams. I had to ask for a renewal of my tutorial on Feynman's diagrams last night. And looking at them made me realize that you very possibly were looking at these diagrams as you were writing the poem. It seems to move in a sort of be a poetic interpretation of a Feynman diagram. So I'm wondering if you could discuss how the form of these diagrams or of other equations even that you've been looking at might pattern the form of some of your writing.
Oh dear.
Is it happening?
Well, actually, I have seen Feynman diagrams, but I think the first time I saw them was when I was co-teaching a class, that class with Brian, and you had a reading of some of his lectures, and which he thought were going to be very simple, right? But they're not, of course. And there's nothing simple about those diagrams. But, you know, they're endlessly fascinating. I can't say that they came into the writing of this poem. I think this came out of, first, that nature program that I saw, and then my conversation with Brian, and I can't remember exactly what Brian said, but it probably had something to do with, and I, you know, only he could say if this makes any sense, because I don't remember, but something to do with opposites, with collisions, with interference, I don't know. The last part of the poem switches to something else, where I was reading an article in Scientific American about an experiment where they managed to slow light down drastically, you know, almost stop it. I don't know what it even means for light to be stopped, if that's even really possible. But mainly the poem, like many of my poems, is just kind of a contrarian, with a contrarian without being hostile, is just wanting to go, how can that be? What does that mean? What would it mean for light to stop, for instance? Some of the questions that I ask probably have good answers, and maybe some can't be answered, and, you know, maybe they're, but I'm just, you know, I am where I am.
I wanted to pick up on the notion of you being a contrarian, and also thinking about you in your introduction to the poems, you were talking about being puzzled. And I think, Brian, mm-hmm. you just mentioned this idea of puzzlement as well. And right after you won the Pulitzer, Dan Chasen in The New Yorker, the critic, mm-hmm. The poetry critic from The New Yorker, said this about your work. The mind describes your poetry as the mind as problem-solving device, almost as calculator. I was wondering what you thought of that assessment, and I also was wondering if you could talk a little bit about, I mean, because I think we often think about problem solving within the sciences, mm-hmm. But we don't often think about it within creative arts and creative practices as well, and I was wondering if you think of your own practice as a kind of problem solving?
In a way, I think of my poems as kind of thought experiments, I guess. I don't really think that I'll come to solutions, but maybe I'll clarify the terms for myself anyway of my questions. So my poems tend to be thought experiments in that they ask things like, well, what would it be like if such and such were true? If such and such were true, what would that look like? What would that feel like? What would it feel like for something to change its chirality? You know, just, I mean, so to that extent, I think that I do have some deep connection to problems, but I don't think I solve them.
I wanted to ask you a little bit about your interest in metaphor or disinterest in metaphor, mm-hmm. as it emerges in your poetry, and also the relationships that emerge. And in some ways, I've read some of these poems as kind of as translations on several levels of concepts from theoretical physics into allegories from the everyday. Mm-hmm. One example would be Dress Up that you read, where you have this dressed electron that, in a manner of speaking, kind of borrows these hypothetical particles, if I've correctly understood, which gives it mass and limits its substantiation or its substantiating its relationship to the electromagnetic mm-hmm. field. So it's a kind of dressing or cross-dressing of electrons that you then compare in your poem to, at least relationally, to the game of dress-up. And I'm interested in your use of these relational passages, which I see as very mm-hmm. Rae Armantrout. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, one passage and a seemingly unrelated passage mm-hmm. that's not—it's just left there for your mm-hmm. understanding. And yet, this seems very different from metaphor, the concept mm-hmm. of metaphor. In the poem Spin, you move from a relationship between space and points to the rhetorical use of points, which mm-hmm. Brandon already, I think, did you mention this already? Or you were talking about this before you read it, right? This mm-hmm. idea of hitting all of the points. Mm-hmm. Right? What does that even mean? So the passage ends mm-hmm. up exposing the inadequacy of a metaphor.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You can't hit all the right points. Mm-hmm. Points are just out there and they're formless. So we can already surmise from another poem that you didn't end up reading, Integer, that you have a certain mistrust of metaphor. You write in Integer, metaphor is ritual sacrifice. It kills the lookalike. So to ask you about the sort of the relational passages in your poems and then your maybe mistrust of mm-hmm. metaphor, if I'm correctly reading this, mm-hmm. can you say a little bit more about your own relationship to metaphorical language and perhaps mm-hmm. talk a little bit more about how physics and the precision of scientific theories, including scientific metaphors, of which there seem to be plenty within quantum mechanics, how that's affected your relationship to poetic representation?
Yeah, well, I am somewhat suspicious of metaphor, but I also know that you can't get away from it, that all thinking is in a way metaphorical, and certainly all language is metaphorical. If you say that we're speaking, I'm not going to say that because I'm not, but if you say that one is speaking at a high level, that's a metaphor. A person's not on a mountain, right? I mean, metaphors are embedded in our everyday language and in our everyday thought, and there's no way we can ever escape them. I think that in a way, and Brian can address this, physics is math, but when it sheds that and tries to present itself in language, then it has to present itself to some extent in metaphorical language, and it runs the risks that metaphor, you know, presents. So I don't think I can get away from metaphor, but I also think that metaphor can be domineering as a rhetorical device. It sort of tends to make one thing subsume another thing, as if that second thing were just in service of the first. That's why I tend not to write conventional rhetorical metaphors. Instead, I kind of juxtapose things that I'd like to consider relations between, but they remain independent things. Kind of, you know, independent states that might have diplomatic relations, right? So that's why often my poems will have parts that are separated by asterisks. And yeah, in the case of the poem Spin that you were talking about, I think that the poem problematizes both uses of point. I mean, you know, the point particle, which has, I guess, only one dimension, right? Is already sort of
zero
dimensions. That's even worse. That's like pre-problematized. Like, what does that, what? And then, you know, the points that the pundit was talking about. If not hearkening back can be a point, then what's a point? You know. So it was, you know, two sort of problematic uses of the word point. Colliding, I guess, in the poem.
Speaking of Spin, if I may, so the winner of the Nobel Prize shared it with Sinitiro Tamanga for the properties of quantum electrodynamics was none other than Richard Feynman, who we heard about. And he responded once to a poem written by Walt Whitman about the tyranny, almost, of the night brought to numbers in the famous poem called When I Heard the Learned Astronomer. Feynman had a response, and he said, "Poets say science takes away from the beauty of the stars, mere globs of gas atoms. I too can see the stars on a desert night and feel them, but do I see less or more? The vastness of the heavens stretches my imagination. Stuck on this carousel, my little eye can catch 1 million-year-old light, a vast pattern of which I am a part. What is the pattern, or the meaning, or the why? It does no harm to the mystery to know a little bit about it. For far more marvelous is the truth than any artists of the past imagined it. Why do the poets of the present not speak of it? What men are poets who speak of Jupiter as if he were a man? But if he is an immense spinning sphere of methane and ammonia, must be silent."
I don't know what poets he was reading, for sure.
Not Emily Dickinson, probably.
No. No, she was actually, you know, had, I think, considering she you know, was writing in the 1860s often, or the 1850s, she had a pretty sophisticated understanding of science. One of her, the poems of hers that we discussed in the class ends, if I can say it properly, in this very both hyper-literal in a way and disturbing way. It goes, "The brain is just the weight of God, for weigh them pound for pound, and they will differ, if they do, as syllable from sound," which already implies that there may be no difference between the brain and God, or no discernible difference, but also the kind of, you know, materialism of weigh them pound for pound is, you know, striking. So that she was probably not one of these poets that Feynman was thinking about. I think he has a straw man there. straw man.
Well, maybe I could follow up on this idea of materiality, and also to kind of follow up on Amelia's question about relationality. Mm-hmm. I think one of the things that I find so pleasurable about the poems is that they really do bring in, as to use your word, in juxtaposition, both the universal and the individual. I think of a line from Lynn Hagenian's work, someone who you know and is part of the language movement, and her well-known book, My Life. She writes, "The universal is animated by individuality." And I think about how there's so much surprise and kind of swiftness to your ability to bring the individual and not just the universal, but the literal universe together in these poems. And I'm thinking about specifically how you bring in your son Aaron, mm-hmm. right, in the poem Entanglements, mm-hmm. or as we heard tonight, the pop culture references like Tony Soprano. And at the same time, you're talking about these really very heady, abstract notions of physics and the physical universe. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about those, your strategies at bringing those things together.
Well, I know that that's one thing that interests me and gets me excited, is the ability to sort of put strange bedfellows together and see how that works, you know, to link, say, things that are supposed to be considered serious and things that are supposed to be considered, you know, just in mere entertainment, for instance, and just, you know, cross those wires and see what sparks fly. Or then with the poem that you referred to that mentions my son Aaron, well, I mean, the entanglements come in all stripes, right? Two particles can interact and become entangled, but there's nothing more entangled than a mother and a son, especially when the son moves away. So, you know, that connection attenuates and yet remains. So again, I guess I was seeing a relation that's not quite a metaphor, but it's a relation between two things that are almost, you know, absurdly different. Nothing's more human than, like, you know, a mother and child or a parent and child relationship. And, you know, nothing's more inhuman, supposedly at least, than, you know, the interaction of subatomic particles. But what happens there, I mean, they both are part of our reality. So what happens when you consider them at one time?
I also wanted to ask about the relationship between one of the poems that you did read, An Entanglement, and I wonder if, before I ask it, you'd like to read Entanglements. Would you mind?
Oh, well, it's in the book. Okay. You know, I wouldn't mind, because I'll do anything, obviously, or I wouldn't be sitting up here. But I left it out of the original choice because it is kind of mysteriously I can't even find it, which is probably me trying to protect myself.
It's okay. We can.
What page? What page is it on? I'll do it. there are no page numbers. I can't even find it. Is it, how far through the book is it?
It's the second poem.
Oh, really? It's not the second poem, because the second poem is Dress Up. All right,
Nope, there it is.
It's the second poem, yeah. It's right after.
Oh, it is. It's between. Okay, I was totally blanking on it. All right. I guess it seems sort of like an extreme example of what I was just talking about in the way it moves from, you know, between the personal and the scientific. Anyway, entanglement. Don't let the car fool you. My treasure is in heaven. The material world is made up entirely of collisions between otherwise indefinite objects. Then what is a collision? Or the physical world collapses into place at the shock of being seen. In the shorter version, tentacled stomach swallows stomach. In a long dream, I'm with Aaron, visiting his future, helping him make choices. You know, obviously, I realize that the mother character in there is being intrusive, not letting go. But you know, what's I guess more disturbing than the fact that this, to some extent, comes off the entangled particles is that it comes directly off the tentacled stomach swallows stomach, which was something about squids, cannibal squids that I that I saw on and another nature program. I watch too many nature programs, and that just seemed to get down to the most disturbing basics of life. You don't even bother with anything but a stomach. Just if a stomach can swallow a stomach, then, you know, what's the rest of this for?
Thank you for indulging me, Rae, because I was about to reference it again, and I was going to feel guilty, but I also just love hearing you read it, and it's a poem that's gotten a lot of attention in the critical poetry community. So on the one hand, I think this book demonstrates the possibilities of mastering some of the beautifully complex concepts that are referenced in these poems, but on the other hand, the book is about asking questions. So in the realm of poetry, it suggests there's this opportunity to connect matter with collective fantasy and imagination, or you might say the phenomenal with the noumenal world outside, depending on, you know, what your philosopher of choice is. So in account, just to go back to that first poem, we find at the very end of the poem, God is balancing his checkbook, God is encrypting his account, this is taking forever. And the poetic voice leads us through a process of attempting to visualize this unvisualizable, of understanding what we at this time can comprehend only through equations. But the tangling up of photons from earlier in this poem is, as I understand, also something that's invisible to the human eye. It's more metaphorical than physical. It's something that we, you know, we have to use equations to conceptualize. So readers of your work would recognize, I think, in this tangling up of photons, the connection to entanglement. Mm-hmm. And, of course, you include it right after. Mm-hmm. And, of course, in the tangled up of the invisible process by which photons transform, there's a different kind of entangling from the entanglements that you were talking about, all these multiple entanglements. So if entanglement moves from metaphysics to physics, right, it starts with this this bumper sticker, don't let the car fool you, my treasure's in
You're
heaven.
You're right, that was a bumper sticker, yeah.
And then finally into the body, the relationship between the poetic alter ego and her son account kind of does the opposite. It moves from physics into metaphysics. So I'm wondering if you could discuss the relationship between these poems and then perhaps even the relationship between the way physics manifests itself in your work a decade ago and how it manifests itself in your work now. Is there...
You know, I find that a hard question. Patrick gave me the list of your questions right, well, I mean, 10
Sorry,
minutes
yeah,
before we started.
Like
and
minutes,
I looked at that and I thought, well, has my work changed? Has my approach to putting physics into poems changed in the last 10 years? And I'm not sure that it has. I mean, I don't know. I guess Entanglements is at least, the poem Entanglements is at least 10 years old. And the poem, on the other hand, Hence, for instance, is pretty recent, like a year and a half maybe, or Emotional Life of Plants is maybe a year and a half old. So you know, there is a temporal range here. I don't know. Do you see a Do you see a change and a difference? Because I don't know.
I see a continuity, mm-hmm. and I certainly see this relationship and your teaching relationship mm-hmm. with Brian coming out. I mean, you know, you mm-hmm. have these poems that come out of your conversations, but I was fascinated by this shift in the metaphysical from mm-hmm. the beginning of the poem to the end of the poem. Mm-hmm. And yeah. I don't know if that's
I think it could go either way yeah. at any time, you know. I think that I can say that the fact that accounts ends with, you know, what God might be doing, you know, and I have heard this balancing the checkbook as a metaphor in, you know, in discussions of virtual particles, right? That is something that, you know, they can, as long as, you know, it can borrow a little energy, enough energy to exist as long as it gives it back right away.
I call that electronic embezzlement.
Yeah, right. There's always some metaphor for that. But, you know, somehow that balancing a checkbook seems kind of old-fashioned now, right? That's already sort of, I mean, superannuated now in the days of electronic banking. So I just sort of skipped to encrypted his account because, you know, and I assume that our accounts are encrypted at banks, let's hope. That's literally true. But also, if God is encrypting his account, then no wonder we can't figure things out or get to the ultimate explanation for the universe. I think I do tend to bring the word God in without meaning it literally, or, you know, without imagining or thinking of God as a sort of person-like entity who created the universe. But I was raised around religion, so the word God comes pretty naturally to me. And when you think about beginnings and ends, it's easy to fall into that language.
I wanted to, I don't know how we're doing with time. I know we do want to open up questions to the audience as well. I had a couple more questions, but maybe I'll just go back to spin. Mm-hmm. I definitely want to get this question in there. And again, I'll just read the stanza that I think really stands out to me. I mean, thinking about spin, and we've kind of been talking about this throughout the panel, we see a scientific discourse becoming a way to critique other discourses, and specifically in this poem, this discourse of politics. Mm-hmm. And so we have that line, the pundit says the candidate's speech hit all the right points. And it's hard, you know, to read that and not think about our current political times. And next week, there is a proposed March for Science scheduled on Earth Day on mm-hmm. April 22nd. And yeah, absolutely, please. And of course, since the election, there's been a host of readings, poetry readings, around the country organized by the group Writers Resist. So I wanted to give you guys an opportunity to talk about the ways that poetry and physics, perhaps more than ever, mm-hmm. Are important to our engagement, both with the natural and political world right now.
Yeah, you mentioned, I think, Steve Burt or one of these critics calling my work skeptical. And I suppose it's true, when you listen to me, you can hear a lot of skepticism. But I think it's important to make a distinction between skepticism and cynicism. And I think if we cultivate a disregard for truth, if we stop believing in the possibility of truth, or we stop seeking truth, then we become cynical and corrupt. We're corrupted. And sometimes it's hard to hear the word truth. It gets bandied around, and you know, there are many ways and reasons to be suspicious when you hear somebody talk about the truth. But on the other hand, we cannot give up, I don't think, on that as an ideal, because, you know, if you do, once you do, I think you're lost, really. And I think that we're seeing that now, with the attack on science that's happening, that would have been unimaginable just, you know, even pretty recently.
I guess I'd say, I think back what Carl Sagan, another great scientist and author, had to say about the dangers of a society that had so much technological capability and power, and the inability of most of its citizens to understand that technology and the science behind it. And I think that's as true as it was, you know, in the 1960s or 70s when he first wrote that. I think, you know, we have a responsibility as scientists, you know, we have equal everybody has equal responsibility in a democracy to you know, contribute to the stewardship of the country. I think it is a perhaps slightly, you know, to be a little less cynical or less extreme. I think, you know, we've been through periods of time before, you know, with great division and you know, so-called alternative facts and truths. I mean, I don't know what you'd call, you know, what happened in the 1940s, propaganda, you know, much more grievous. But it is our responsibility to both as educators, but also as scientists ourselves to contribute to this more as a thought process and how you think scientifically, you look at evidence, and trying to harmonize that without interjecting your own personal political, you know, viewpoint. I think the country will be just fine. I do feel like we've been through you know, difficult times in the past. I do think it's the responsibility, obligation of scientists to, you know, to contribute to that dialogue as well.
I'd be happy to ask one more question if there's time for it, and then we can maybe open it up. But I wanted to ask about the poem Chirality. And it's a poem that's narrated from the hypothetical perspective of a particle. And it, a particle, as I understand from my in-house informant, has no mass, and therefore it travels at the speed of light. But with mass, it would never be able to reach the speed of light. So an observer, if you have an observer, that actually changes what is there as well. It changes the very nature of the particle, and you're playing with this in the poem. The poem starts, "If I didn't need to do anything, would I?" And then later, "Would I summon a beholder?" So the word chirality itself is then defined two-thirds of the way through the poem. A massless particle passes through the void with no resistance. So that is to say, a massless particle has chirality. There's an urgency here and elsewhere to understand what this means to the particle or to the subject of the poem. Ask what it means to pass through the void, the speaker notes. And there's a kind of alchemy of observation in this poem, both within the subject of particle physics, but also in the poem itself. Merely asking a question changes the nature of a thing, or merely observing it changes its nature. So I'm wondering if you can talk about how inquiry works in your poetry. How does asking a question change our perception of an object or of our own human condition?
I wish I had the answer to that. You know, that's really an unanswerable question.
But I'd love for you to just
riff on it. Huh? Okay. Well, I
because
I,
you talk. Of, I mean, elsewhere, this comes up elsewhere as well when you talk about the electron.
The Armantrout uncertainty principle.
I am fascinated, of course, by Copenhagen interpretation of the of quantum collapse, which I don't think it's even the dominant interpretation anymore, but basically it's like a subatomic particle can be in, have many spins, be in many places, is basically undefinable until measured, and then it behaves like a classical object and has a definite location, etc. Einstein couldn't get over this either. He said, well, if a mouse observed it, would it collapse? Who has to observe it? But you can't get past the fact, this happens with the chirality issue too, that there is this privileged place for the observer that often keeps popping up. And what is the observer doing? The observer isn't just, you know, languidly observing. The observer is measuring, and therefore that means asking a question. And it's, that's in the poem Outburst, where I wrote the present, what if the present is a best guess on a pop quiz? Well, that's the pop quiz, the measurement, the question, you know, and it sort of brings existence into being that maybe wasn't there before, that maybe was in just a potential state until asked, you know, are you there? And then boom, yep, I'm here.
Well, good. So I would like to open the conversation up to you guys. And I believe we have some microphones floating around in space somewhere. Patrick? So if you have a microphone, you'd like to give a talk. It's hard to see you back here, up here, but please come to a microphone and ask away. And I'll handle all questions on poetry.
Mm-hmm.
And
okay.
Rae will take quantum electrodynamics.
To begin with, I'm neither a poet or a physicist. I want to disagree with the panel somewhat on one question, but it will lead to another question, which will open up possibilities. So that's optimistic at the end. I would disagree that there was no conflict between poetry and physics, certainly with Newtonian physics. The Romantics were actually reacting against the fact that the understanding of the natural world as scribed by Newton was sort of the beginning of understanding everything. And so therefore, there was, in a sense, a kind of, how should I say, a kind of problem for imagination. Now, I realize that both in physics and in poetry, there was both reason and imagination. But in physics, reason is the dominant form and imagination secondary, okay? So the poets in the 19th century were definitely reacting against that because they wanted to mm-hmm. elevate imagination. Mm-hmm. In fact, it became almost bipolar in their relationship.
Mm-hmm. Blake, for instance, was obsessed with Newton and was, you know, very, perhaps like Dirac is obsessed with poetry, you know, I mean, but he had he felt persecuted by Newton.
Yeah, so it seems to me like that was because it seems like the answers were already given and the poets were not satisfied with that. But in contemporary physics, since there was so many avenues and so many mysteries and so much dark matter and particularly astrophysics, so many universes opening up, that it just seems like it's an opportunity now for imagination to seep into mm-hmm. science. And so therefore, a greater opportunity between a fusion between poetry and physics.
Mm-hmm.
I would say that your defense of the compatibility in an ideal way was not correct, but I think in the current state it's more correct now.
Mm-hmm.
Would you not say that?
Yeah, I was probably thinking, if you're addressing that to me, I was probably thinking of the more contemporary circumstances.
More audience questions. Come on, there's got to be some people as confused as I am about poetry and physics.
Hi there. My question is for Rae. You seem to have meticulous attention to detail, every word, every placement of that word on the page. There's a purpose. And I was wondering if you would speak at all about punctuation.
Mm-hmm.
Some of your poetry, well, for example, is it close or is it close?
Oh, the title of, you're mm-hmm. talking about the title of a poem.
Right, in Entanglements.
That's close.
Close. It has no period at the end.
I often, not always, but often leave off the final period because I kind of want to suggest that I haven't reached a conclusion.
Mm. That's beautiful. With that being said, do you take a lot of time to make that decision? Do you come back to your poems to decide, am I done? Is there more to solve here?
Sometimes I come back and decide that I should have put a period after that word. So sometimes that's a kind of vexed problem for me.
And how long does it take you to do a poem? I mean, do you do...
It varies. It really, I mean, you know, some of my favorite of my poems I wrote very quickly, but that's rare. More often it takes, you know... Well, I want to say it takes months and months, but that's not true. It's a couple weeks, maybe.
Like Brian was saying about creativity taking incubation, just like science, do you think that putting it away and coming to it, that there's more there? Do you ever look at editing like that?
I think that can be useful sometimes to put something away and then, especially if you feel stuck, you know, yeah. if you feel like you have just hit a wall, sometimes if you put it away and then come back and look at it fresh, you come up with a different angle. That's true.
Mm-hmm. And Brian, do you have poetry yourself?
Say that one more time.
Do you have poetry yourself?
Do I write poetry?
Are you a closet poet?
Ah, yes. Very, very deeply in the closet. No, I don't think I could be. I did resent, you know, all these years of class, because I think it puts up a false narrative that you can't do both. You can't be a poet and appreciate physics, as Rae, you know, astonishingly disproves, and you can't appreciate poetry, as Feynman says, if you're a physicist. And that's why, you know, I resented that there's poetry for physicists, which kind of, you know, almost is demeaning towards the arts, I would say. Just getting back to your previous question to Rae, one delightful thing on the podcast, which I encourage you to listen to, Into the Impossible, Rae talks about this this disharmony, if you will, of the creative process, which is imaginative and, you know, vibrant with some strokes of genius, but also the necessity of self-editing and how they are in conflict. So I encourage people to listen to the podcast. She has a very delightful description. And I think, you know, you mentioned about punctuation. I think, you know, you couldn't write an equation that had, you know, one side of the equation equals and then they don't equal each other. That's, you know, pathologically impossible. So, but that's what's delightful about poetry, that you have this opportunity for two things, you know, not to be congruous in some sense and still have it, quote unquote, you know, equate. Mm-hmm. I love that. Some questions over here.
Oh, Stephanie, hello.
Thank you. This is a really wonderful, wonderful conversation. So my question is for you, Brian. Would it be possible to do your research without language? Mm. Because how could you even get to the questions, and how would you know what is drawing you from the universe?
Yeah.
To research if no, you didn't have language.
Important questions. Yeah, there's a lot of metaphor in physics. I mean, you can't get around making a model. There's no such thing as a triangle, right? I can't hand you a triangle. I can only analogize it to, well, there's a star over there, there's a star over here, et cetera. The notions of things that humans can take for granted, almost like infinity, we heard in a poem. You know, there's really no, that's an abstraction, you know, to some extent. Imaginary numbers, we have all sorts of things. Point, you know, the very notion of point, you think about pointing with your finger, you think about point, something with zero dimensions, how crazy is that? So you have to abstract, in a sense, to build a model, which can then be confronted with observation and evidence. And I think that's part of the problem with physics nowadays. There are aspects of physics which in themselves may not be subject to evidence. In other words, they may predict things that are entirely unobservable, or at least unobservable in our current, you know, and foreseeable future. And then how do you test the analogy's correctness or not? I mean, what matters is that something's correct. It might be beautiful mathematically, and that may have value and does have value frequently, but how do you connect that to reality in a sense that can be analogized to something that can be tested against observation is what interests many physicists, not all, but over there, Professor Meyer.
Actually, I'm not going to ask a question. My daughter was inspired by Rae and is taking Brian's instruction that some people recite poems seriously. So she wrote a poem while you were speaking. She's going to recite it for
okay,
you.
Eleanor,
or read it for you.
Take it away.
Science, surfing through the wave of DNA. Ça, c'est une très bonne discipline scolaire. In the negative and positive charges. Éduque les personnes les plus intelligentes du monde. Not a single soul who knows all atoms. Certains mots ont beaucoup de questions. Energy has everything inside.
Wow. Wow.
I should point out she is 8 years old. I mean, come on.
That was great.
Thank you. Rae is taking out an option, or Amelia can take out an option on her as a next graduate student.
That's a good answer to the first question. It turns out, at least today, poetry and physics are not are no longer irreconcilable.
Oh, that's right. Harmonious. Yes, over here.
All right. Hi, Ms. Armantrout. I was a student of yours in fall 2015. I don't know if you remember me or not.
You look familiar.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So, I want to say that I didn't actually know anything about your poetry until, you know, Mr. Som introduced it to us in this experimental writing class that we are taking under his guidance. And I have to say that I appreciate the fact that you did write poetry based around the idea of physics, because it's something, you know, different, obviously, and I do think that science does play an important role in the creative process. I am a fiction writer. I mostly like to write fantasy, and I do think that even extending to other genres, that the sciences can help inspire new creativity and new ideas in the wide range of literature genres. And in my case, I really like chemistry and biology, and I find those to be really inspiring and very interesting. And especially in a school like this that puts the focus on science, I think it's important for, like what the panel brought up in general, that putting two and two together is an important way to bridge this sort of, I guess, like gap that we have between the literature department and something like the sciences department. And so in general, I also, yeah, I bought the book too. I think I was the first person who bought it. Yes.
Good.
I will say that I noticed that you put in the dedication for John Granger, and I also really like John Granger. He's one of my favorite professors here on campus, and I was just, I wanted to ask why in particular it was for John Granger.
Well, because he really has inspired me. A lot of the reading that I've done in physics has been books that he's recommended. He's a wonderful reader and just a very lively mind. He's moved to New York now, so we won't be seeing him around. But many of, you know, the book by Nick Lane that I mentioned in terms of my poem, The Emotional Life of Plants, John recommended that to me. He recommended something by Carlo Rovelli to me. So he just is kind of, you know, out there ahead, picking up the good stuff and showing me where it is.
That's really interesting. I also wanted to ask if on making, I noticed that while light has caught up in that stanza, mm-hmm. While has two L's. Was that intentional or was that a typo?
That's a typo. That must be, that's not me.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, well, let me see. I have to look at that now. It's easy to read right past typos because you don't, you know, you're right. No. Not that way in my copy.
Thank you for sharing your poetry. Really appreciate it.
Thanks for coming.
Thanks. A question on this side.
Hello, my name is Sarah Haviland. I'm majoring in aerospace engineering and minoring in creative writing, so I definitely have a huge sympathy for the intersection between the sciences and the arts. And I wanted to ask you a question about the quote, metaphor is ritual sacrifice, it kills the lookalike, because I think that hits upon something really true and really important. And I hope this doesn't come across as disrespectful, but isn't that phrase itself a metaphor?
Yeah. No, that doesn't come across as disrespectful to me. I mean, I said to begin with that you can't get away from metaphor.
Yeah.
And I don't even want to, you know. I mean, obviously I enjoy it, you know. Mm-hmm. I'm playing with it all the time, but I'm playing with it in a way that, you know, watches it carefully, I guess.
Yeah. Thank you.
On this side.
Hello, Jason.
Hello. this question is mostly addressed for you, Ray. So I was surprised when you were doing the readings of the variety and the frequency of the references in your poems, and it got me thinking, like, when you read The Emotional Life of Plants, the number of times you said left, like, made me think of, you know, the, like, how, like, in the, like, the photosynthetic reaction center, like, it's more or less symmetrical, but for some reason, the energy only travels down one side, and I was, like, might have been, like, making that up in my mind, but then, like, you, read Entanglements, where, like, the first two lines, I think you said, like, don't let the car fool you, my, like, treasure lies above, or, like, in heaven. And it seemed like a pretty, like, a clear reference, like, Anne Bradstreet. So I was, like, thinking, it got me thinking about, like, what you were talking about with, like, your juxtapositions and, I guess, your metaphors. Like, how deliberately, like, when you write your poems, do you, like, structure your poems around these metaphors or juxtapositions versus, like, approaching it from, like, the language first and, like, letting it float in?
Oh, it's always language first with me, you know? I mean, I think you can... You can probably really see that if you think about it. I mean, you know, I'll be reading, let's say, something about physics, and the word dressed or renormalization will pop out. Or in the poem that you were talking about, The Emotional Life of Plants, the word exciton. The fact that I wrote a poem comes from the word exciton. I went, wait, there's a thing called an exciton? Are we all made of excitons? How exciting. It always really starts with the language, and certainly not with the kind of deliberation that you're talking about. I think this is one thing that I said on the podcast, is that to be a creative writer, you have to be sort of spontaneous, and you have to give yourself the permission to be spontaneous, and you kind of have to trust yourself even when it feels crazy. But you also have to be able to edit yourself and have to be capable of being self-critical, you know. So you have to let yourself go and then at some point take a look at what you wrote and go, So, but I think the initial impulse is to just, you know, not censor yourself too much.
Thank you.
Question on this side next.
Hi. Thank you very much for sharing your poem. They are, I love them so much. And so my name is Dybul, and I'm here as a first-year student with an undecided major. But I'm probably going to head towards one of the STEM majors, but I do have a strong interest in the arts and the humanities and the creative processes. So I remember the panel talked about Whitman's When I Heard the Learned Astronomer. I remember hearing the poem and was deeply impressed by it, and the idea that somehow the trying to understand the stars via science kind of like ripped away the beauty that was associated to it. And I also noted that your poem also associate a lot of scientific phenomenons, a lot of scientific phenomena and scientific laws with the human interaction, the emotional side of us, not just the logical side of us.
Right.
And so as recently, I've been digging deeper into mathematics, and I took a lot more classes in the more theoretical and fundamental side of math. And I can't help but wonder to myself, like, why do we care about this stuff? Like, the thing is just so much of a constraint, like arbitrary dimensions, imaginary numbers, and just doesn't seem to me to be tangible. So my question is, since you associate, I think your association with the scientific phenomena with human interaction is very lovely, but do you think there's anything inherently beautiful in the formality of, like, say, theoretical mathematics?
Well, I know so little about theoretical mathematics, but I have known mathematicians in my life, and I think that it's a passion for them. And I think in a way they're like artists, maybe even more than scientists are, because they are doing something whether or not it's useful. I mean, sometimes it turns out to be useful, but they don't really care, you know, that they love numbers. I mean, numbers are very real to them. And very beautiful, I think. And I'm kind of in awe of mathematicians that way. I don't understand it very well, but there's a very kind of pure passion in it, I think. It's not for everyone, of course.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Hello there. So you mentioned earlier how your inspiration came from mini books and nature documentaries. I wanted to ask you, and essentially everyone on the panel, for someone who's trying to become an artist or become a poet or become a physicist, and say they're lacking that inspiration, that spark that gets them going, where would you recommend them to start their search?
You take this one, Brian.
I was going to ask
I've been
Brandon.
Talking too much.
Yeah, why don't we ask Amelia and Brandon?
Oh, yeah, you guys take it.
Amelia.
It's a very broad question. Are you speaking specifically about where to go in science? Because if so, I think we should turn it back to Brian.
I mean, in the sense of both, like, the whole topic of this discussion, you know, poetry and physics, like, for someone who was interested in both, I guess you could say.
Where so maybe we should just go through the panel and each name, like, the first book that comes to mind that we find inspiring.
No, I don't want to start.
I would start, if you're looking for inspiration and you're interested in this collision between the sciences and poetry, I would look at the Russian poet Osip Mandelstam. Very good translations are done of his work.
I think I may have misunderstood your question. I was thinking you were asking where you might turn for inspiration as an artist and as a physicist. And I just feel like for me, what this panel and Ray's work shows is that whatever you decide, you should read broadly and be open to all kinds of sources across disciplines. Whether that be, you know, watching David Attenborough films or other nature documentaries or sitting down with something with contemporary poetry, right? To not, going back to the first question, to not be fooled by these kind of false divisions between the disciplines, but to read and experience things widely.
Answer?
Yeah, I just said Mandelstam.
Mandelstam, okay. How can I forget? So I'm going to say, well, I should say there's a lot of nonsense that attempts to bridge the gap between the arts and physics especially lends itself to a lot of sloppy thinking and a lot of wooliness. And there's actually a book called The Dancing Wooly Masters. And I always get a little bit concerned when people tell me that's their exposure to physics. And they're, you know, it's equally the Tao of physics is another bad one. I also would not recommend, like, Stephen Hawking. You know, maybe I'll give you the list of books I wouldn't recommend. Stephen Hawking, I remember seeing him going to a lecture of his at the Royal Society in London 20 years ago, and he could still respond to questions in more or less real time. And somebody asked him, you know, why did you write this book, A Brief History of Time? It's rumored that nobody understands it, and nobody's actually completed it, but they like to have it on their bookshelf. He said, that's fine. I needed to pay for my daughter's college tuition. So that's you know, sort of the motivation for it, which doesn't make for the greatest, most easy reading book. I will recommend wholeheartedly a book by a friend of mine, my best friend from graduate school, is Professor Stefan Alexander at Brown University. He wrote a book called The Jazz of Physics, and it's about it's both memoir as his story as the only African-American theoretical cosmologist in the country, and how he has this unique trajectory from the South Bronx to the Ivy League halls of power and knowledge, but also connecting theoretical physics and ideas as diverse as quantum electrodynamics, minimization principles, and things that are actually mathematical and technical, but also with the personal and humorous along the way, reconciling what he considers the improvisational nature of theoretical physics with, obviously, he's also a professional jazz musician. So he's a unique Renaissance individual. And there's a lot of good cosmology and physics in it, so I would recommend that. The Jazz of Physics.
Well, it's hard for me to just come up with one name. I think if you're interested in poetry, there are a lot of good poetry anthologies. And what you do is you know, most of the poetry you find in an anthology probably won't touch you, but you may find something that does. And then if that's the case, then you find a book by that person, and then you find two books by that person, and then you find somebody who's sort of like that person, and you get their books, and, you know, follow the track that way.
Thank you.
Okay, maybe one or so more questions. Yeah, there's one over there.
Hi.
Hi, Cassidy. How's it going?
Good, thanks. How about you?
Pretty good.
So I was going to ask about sort of how you see this sort of genre of studying science poetically as it relates to sort of poetry, like how it is now, because there are always, of course, movements of poetry that just kind of get categorized sort of after the fact. You know, you don't sit around a table and say we're going to call ourselves the language poets.
Right, but, exactly.
You know, eventually it does kind of, like, it becomes part of a thing. So writing about science, not writing about the planet or Earth or the state of the Earth, but actually writing about, like, physics and biology, do you think that's is just an interest of yours that you think kind of stands on its own, or is it something that's sort of happening in poetry right now?
I don't think it's happening widely, but it is happening. I can think of, off the top of my head, of two other poets who are very interested in this. Amy Contanzano, who actually went to CERN, and she got a grant to go and interview people, scientists there, and to be, you know, shown the accelerator and be inspired by it. Mm-hmm. Andrew Joron, who's somebody who has a degree in history of science and who writes in a very lovely way about it. So I can think of those two, and I'm sure there are others. Let's see. Well, it's not coming to my mind right now, but I think that the very sort of ambiguity and uncertainty, the famous uncertainty in quantum physics can appeal to lots of people, maybe unfortunately sometimes, and also to poets. And I think there are those who maybe use it as a license to, you know, go somewhere a little bit cheesy, and then there are people who try to be a little more careful. But I don't think it's exactly a movement. When it turns into a movement, then I hope I'm still around then.
So I would like to ask you, the audience, well, first of all, let me thank my fellow panelists here. It's a real treat to be here with such impressive scholars and as I say, my mentor, Rae. So I want to ask you, the audience, to recite a poem, okay? And you all know this poem, and it's in honor of Rae Armantrout's birthday today.
Oh,
so the poem is Happy Birthday to You. So let us sing it along, shall we? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Rae. Happy birthday to you. And with that, I'll invite you out into the hall. We have some refreshments, including a birthday cake.